I was just checking if I can see the text without my glasses. I'm not very sure, so I'm going to put them back on. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the fifth Sir Isaiah Berlin Memorial Lecture. The first four lectures were given by Timothy Gard-Nash, Ian Buruma, Anne Applebaum, and Michael Ignatieff. Traditionally, the patron of the Isaiah Berlin Association, former president of Latvia Vaida Vītja Freiberga, introduces the keynote speaker. But this year, she's unable to attend, and I have the honor. Our speaker tonight is John Gray, philosopher, historian of ideas, and a student of human nature. He contends that human nature has not changed over time, at least not for the better, a view that has earned him the reputation for pessimism. John Gray has held eminent academic posts at Oxford, Harvard, and Yale, among others. He was professor of European thought at the London School of Economics until 2008, when he retired from academic life to devote himself full-time to writing. Gray is a prolific and lucid writer. He is lead book reviewer for The New Statesman and a regular contributor to other publications, including the New York Review of Books and the Times Literary Supplement. His 22 books include works on John Stuart Mill, Hayek, and Voltaire. The publication, the book False Dawn, The Delusions of Global Capitalism, came out in 1998. Straw Dogs, Thoughts on Humans and Other Animals, in 2002. His latest book, The Silence of Animals, on Progress and Other Modern Myths, in 2013. And, as well, his 1995 Isaiah Berlin was republished this year with a new introduction under the title Isaiah Berlin, An Interpretation of His Thought. From the subject matter and titles of this small selection of his work, one begins to get a taste of Gray's concerns. For Latvian readers who have not yet had the opportunity to do so, I would highly recommend savoring the excellent interview of John Gray by Arnis Rītups in this month's Rīgas Laiks. It is a good introduction to Gray, wherein he ruminates on man's awareness of his mortality and the desire to overcome it, man's need for myths, the humanist heritage from Christian monotheism, offering sense or redemption in history and the present, his skepticism for the secular belief in the inevitability of progress, history as both cyclical and chaotic, the imperfection of man and his immutable nature, the importance of doubt, ethics, politics, and progress, Isaiah Berlin, and the need to see. Since he himself is here today, I will not waste your time by telling you my thoughts on what John Gray thinks, but let him tell you himself. I give you the illustrious John Nicholas Gray.
It's a very great honor to be giving this lecture here in Isaiah Berlin's birthplace today. I must caution you right at the start that I can't hope to emulate either Isaiah Berlin's wisdom, his profundity, or his fluency of style. In every respect, I'm a much more modest creation than, and I don't hope to do that. Nor do I hope to speak for him or to claim that my interpretation of his ideas is one he would have shared in every respect, or that he would have agreed with the way I apply his ideas to current problems in the world. But what I want to do is to suggest that we have a great deal to learn from Berlin's thinking today. Sometimes the lessons are uncomfortable. Sometimes they may strike people as disillusioning. But I think it's extremely important to imbibe and apply something of the type of liberalism that was the type of thinking about freedom that was illustrated in the wonderful film by David Herman, in which Isaiah Berlin described a type of concern with freedom, a type of liberalism which is both stoical, in that it accepts that the pursuit of freedom always involves some losses, and skeptical, in that it accepts that there are many dilemmas, many moral and political dilemmas, to which there's no right solution. There are many, if you like, moral and political conflicts or problems that aren't fully soluble. That's his view. It's also my view. I have three particular thoughts to present to you today, each of them, I think, being anticipated to some degree by what Berlin said in that wonderful film. The first is Berlin's view. The title of my talk is Berlin on the Meaning of Freedom, but what I'll begin with is by talking about what freedom, according to Berlin, and I share Berlin's view on this, what freedom is not. The second thought I'll try and explain is how freedom, understood in this way, is under threat in the world today. What are the chief threats I think we should be aware of? And thirdly, for obvious reasons, because this is a talk I'm giving in Riga, freedom and Russia. I'll talk a bit about Berlin's view of Russia, which is different from, he loved Russia in many ways. Part of his reason for going in 1945, which he said changed him for the rest of his life, was that he always said that he learned a great deal from 19th century Russian thinkers. And also because he thought that the singular fate of Russia, the singular destiny of Russia, the singular horror of Soviet communism, which destroyed so many lives, either by, in the case of millions of them, or tens of millions, by ending them prematurely, but also destroyed them by ruining lives of people who lived on, but with their lives irreparably damaged. He thought that singular horror was not inevitable. It might not have happened if a more fortunate series of contingencies had developed. And so I want to say something about that too. So they are the three thoughts or three topics I want to address tonight. And the first is what freedom is not. Now, Berlin in that interview anticipated freedom, he said, is not happiness. It's not justice. It's not equality. It's none of those things. Now, I want to go on and say it's not democracy. It's not even human rights, which I think Berlin would also agree with. We tend to think now, or we've come to think, that whenever democracy replaces dictatorship or authoritarianism, freedom necessarily expands. We've forgotten what Isaiah Berlin knew and a whole generation of earlier thinkers earlier in the 20th century and in the 19th century knew, which is that there can be such a thing as illiberal democracy. That's to say, democracy which does not promote freedom or is even hostile to it. By that I mean, we can see in the world today, for example, we can see countries that are democratic in the sense that elections have uncertain outcomes. No one can predict no one can say the election is wholly rigged, so they have uncertain outcomes. But recurrently, when governments are elected, they don't respect the freedom of individuals or minorities. On the contrary, they may attack the freedom of minorities in many ways. And they may be even fairly consistently hostile to what are often called liberal values, by which I mean respect for individual freedom and dignity, tolerance, respect for minorities and their ways of life. And I think this is a very important insight, something that is crucial to remember at this point in human history, because there is a kind of view, a naive view, that all that is needed to promote freedom is to get rid of tyrants. All that is needed to have freedom in the world is to eliminate a tyrant. But as I would argue, and I think Berlin would probably share this view, freedom isn't a natural human condition. If you remove obstacles to freedom, if you remove the tyrant, if you remove the dictator, if you remove the structure of unfreedom, what emerges is not freedom necessarily. Sometimes it's anarchy. That's happened in some of the destruction of dictatorships in places like Libya and Iraq. And in other cases, possibly in post-communist Russia, what emerges is a kind of mixture of an illiberal democracy, authoritarian rule, and surviving elements of the Soviet regime. A kind of hybrid of that. I remember an interview, it was rather an honest interview, but in a way shocking, with the American economist Milton Friedman, not long before he died, a very lucid and, I believe, honest thinker. And he confessed, he said, what I thought was all you needed to create freedom, free markets and free personal relations, was to get rid of the communist state. Once you'd gotten rid of it, there would be freedom. He said, I was very surprised when what happened was gangsterism and mafia rule. And so that's kind of, is a kind of fundamental illusion. Getting rid of dictatorship can abolish one freedom or set of freedom, can enhance freedom in some ways, and at the same time remove it. If you don't have the underlying structure of laws and of institutions in which freedom is embodied. Now, freedom and democracy go together in much of post-communist Europe. When totalitarianism is destroyed and replaced by democracy, democracy and freedom go together. But in much of the many other contexts of the world, that doesn't happen. And that's because I think totalitarianism of the sort that undoubtedly existed in the former Soviet state of which, in which Latvia was forcibly incorporated, is a comprehensive eclipse or destruction of freedom, or at least an attempted destruction of freedom in all of its forms. So when the totalitarian regime collapses or is overthrown, freedom is created. Freedom emerges, especially when there is historical memory of what freedom actually once was. And of course, that wasn't the case in Russia, because the Soviet regime had been there for over 70 years. No one remembered what it was like to live in a freer society. And so what emerged from the Soviet collapse, along with many mistakes in Russia and in Western policy, was something quite different from what most people expected. So my first thing is that though democracy is a good thing, it's something different from freedom. Remember what Berlin said, each thing is what it is and not another thing. Freedom is freedom, democracy is democracy. And I think Berlin would have agreed with Bertrand Russell. He didn't in general agree with Bertrand Russell, though he cited him there. When Bertrand Russell was on towards the end of his life, remember Bertrand Russell was born in 1872 and died in 1970, that's to say he was 98. He remembered his grandfather talking about his grandfather's meeting with Napoleon. That's how old he was. And Russell was once asked, is England, this was in I think the 1950s, freer than it used to be when you were a young man? He said, no, it's much less free. He said, in my day, we never met a policeman. There were very few laws. There were no border controls. There were no passports. You could travel anywhere in Europe except Russia and Turkey without a passport. It's much less free, he said, but it's better. That's a Berlinian answer. There's less freedom in the negative sense, but on the whole, he thought, England in 1950 or 1952 or whenever this interview occurred was a better society, though there was less freedom. So freedom isn't democracy. Freedom may be, democracy may be, as Winston Churchill famously put it, he said, it's a terrible form of government, but all the others are much worse. That may be true, but it's not freedom. Freedom isn't, on Berlin's view and on my view, it isn't what might be called personal autonomy either. personal autonomy I take as a particular ideal of life in which each of us, it's a rather romantic ideal also found in the 19th century English liberal thinker John Stuart Mill, by the way, Bertrand Russell's godfather. Liberalism has a certain family dynastic respect aspect in Britain, though not in the case of Berlin, who was an immigrant. Freedom is in this sense of serving an ideal of a personal autonomy is when each person tries to be the author or even the artist of their lives. They try to make their lives a creation from their own choices and their own imagination. Now, Berlin held, and I share this view completely, that that is a very valuable ideal, an important ideal, but he also held that freedom was useful and valuable and even necessary to many people who didn't have that ideal. Supposing what you want to do is to follow a code of conduct, like an Orthodox Jew or a traditional Catholic or a Muslim, you don't want to create your own life. You want to live by a tradition or you want to live by a code. People who think like that also need freedom in the negative sense that he explained when he discussed freedom in the interview, namely freedom meaning the ability to act as one pleases and as one wishes, without being obstructed by other human beings. And the vast majority of maybe human beings who have no clear ideal, who don't want to create their lives like artists, but don't want to live by a code of rules either, but simply want to get through their lives reasonably successfully and happily, they too need freedom. So freedom, the value of freedom for Berlin is not that it serves autonomy or that it's necessarily connected with democracy or that it's the core of human rights. Really, freedom for Berlin in this negative sense, its chief value comes from the varieties of good life that freedom permits. The life of someone who's an Orthodox Jew, the life of someone who is a John Stuart Mill liberal, the life of someone who belonged to the Bloomsbury group of artists and thinkers in the early 20th century, of which the economist Maynard Keynes belonged, they're all forms of the good life. There's a plurality of different good ways in which people can live. And this brings out an important feature of Berlin's idea of freedom, which didn't occur in the film, which is that on the one hand, it's a tragic doctrine. It says when there's a choice of a particular pattern of good in a human life, there's always loss. But from another angle, it's a doctrine of abundance. That completely different lives can be good. We tend to inherit from Aristotle the idea that as lives get better and better, they become more and more similar. The ideal being a property-owning Greek male, middle-aged, prosperous enough not to have to work, but with plenty of servants and female company. That's what everyone wants. Well, Berlin's view is much more copious, much more wide. There are many different ways, incompatible, can be mixed to a certain extent, some of them completely incompatible, which human beings can live well. Indeed, he goes further, and I think it's even more important. There are many, many different ways in which any single human being could live well. And I think that's a very liberating doctrine. It's not only a doctrine of tragedy and loss, though it is also that in many, particularly often in politics and so on. But it's a doctrine of the abundance of the good life. So the chief value of freedom for Berlin is that freedom, the negative freedom of which he speaks, makes this abundance possible. It allows the abundance of different types of good life to coexist with one another and be practically realizable. Now, how is that type of freedom under threat in the world today? Now I am moving in a way from Berlin to trying to illustrate his ideas as I interpret them. He might have differed. When I showed him my book about him, he said, wonderful book, entirely true. He said, but there are 23 things which I think are slightly wrong. So I don't claim that this would be what I say now is his view. But there are three respects. I draw attention, not the only large threats to freedom, but three threats to freedom I'd like to focus on as being relevant in Europe and in the world today and in Latvia. in the past, in the period following the Second World War, and throughout much of the history of Europe and of the West in the 20th and 19th centuries, freedom went, free societies were generally more prosperous than unfree societies. Those of you who've lived through communism, as everyone has here who's old enough to remember it, will know, as I know from visiting communist countries in the Cold War period in Europe quite frequently, will know that in economic terms, communism was an extremely wasteful, destructive, and outside of a few sectors in the Soviet Union, outside the military sector and some related sectors, generally speaking, a failure. It didn't create the prosperity it promised. And indeed, when Gorbachev allowed people from the Soviet bloc to travel freely, and not just a few select individuals, some of them I met when they came, they were horrified to discover that fairly senior members of the Soviet elite had a quality of life which was not as good as that of an unemployed worker in Liverpool. In other words, Western societies were not only freer, but they were much richer, even for the poorest members of them. It was a shock. So in the past, in a sense, liberal societies that cherish freedom as well as democracy had an advantage. They were also the richest. They also advanced quickly economically. And authoritarian or totalitarian regimes were generally poor or stagnant or not very productive. But today, authoritarian regimes outside of this North Korea, I don't think there are very few genuinely totalitarian regimes now, but today authoritarian regimes can't be relied upon to be economically backward. China is an authoritarian regime, it's dictatorial. If you oppose the regime on certain crucial issues, if you belong to an unpopular movement or sect, if you're Tibetan or belong to some other minority, your fate can be very terrible. But it's also had the largest and the fastest industrialization in the history of the world, faster than anything that was achieved in the West. And hundreds of millions of people who 30 years ago or 20 years ago were really poor are no longer really poor. And that's an authoritarian regime. While in Europe, is large parts of Europe outside Germany and its immediate zone, large parts of Europe are stagnant or contracting, haven't achieved the level of productivity and wealth that they had in 2007, 2008, and indeed large parts of Europe are still shrinking. And in the US, which until recently had recovered more than other countries from the financial crisis, is now in a state of self-induced paralysis, flirting with disaster yet again. I was in Washington a week ago, and I was struck by the immense complacency of everyone there. They all predicted there would be a shutdown. There has been. They all then predicted that the debt limit would be raised. Let's hope they were right. Because if they aren't right, we have a big shock in store. Mill, who I first studied when I was getting to know Isaiah in 1972, 1973, I was first studying Mill, and we had many interesting conversations about John Stuart Mill, wrote in 1859 of European dynamism and Chinese immobility. No one would talk about European dynamism and Chinese immobility now. We have, in many ways, the opposite. And when freedom doesn't seem to go with prosperity, it's at greater risk. The attachment of most human beings to freedom is increased when they can see around them that freedom actually enables them and others around them to live materially better. When less free societies are advancing economically, freedom is somewhat at risk. And that leads me to my second threat to freedom, which is that the political consequences of economic stagnation in much of Europe at the moment, certainly in the southern part of Europe, the so-called periphery, although it also includes large countries such as Spain and Italy, that economic stagnation seems to me to be dangerous to freedom. And that's not simply my opinion. I think it's a fact that some of the old demons of Europe in the 20th century, I mean anti-Semitism, hatred of Roma, hatred of gay people, hatred of immigrants and minorities. Some of those demons are on the march again, not only in Greece, but also in Hungary, and also Italy, actually, as well. And that is at least partly, I think, because of the economic stagnation and contraction which exists in those countries. I don't see any danger of a return of dictatorship as in the 1930s. That won't happen for many reasons. Democracy is fairly firmly entrenched in pretty much all of Europe. The danger is more that democracy will be poisoned or deformed and become illiberal. And I think that has actually already happened to some degree in Hungary, for example, and in pretty well many of the way, France, Italy, as I mentioned, not yet in Spain, but certainly in Greece, we've had a reemergence of the far right. Back in about 1992, I was asked in Poland, what will come after the new right? I said, after the new right, you can confidently expect the old right. And I'm afraid that's happened. The old ethnic nationalist, the right based on hatred of minorities. And of course, in Russia, now we have a return of some of the worst aspects of the Soviet regime, a return of xenophobia, attacks on gay people. We have all kinds of dark developments occurring against the background of a manipulated, managed, but still, I think, compared at least with the Soviet system, a type of authoritarian or illiberal democracy. Now, I know that in post-communist countries, such as Latvia, integration into Europe is valued and cherished, and I think that's perfectly reasonable. If I were Latvian, I would have probably followed exactly the same policies that the Latvian government has followed. Because integration with Europe has in some many cases, in Slovakia for example, protected liberal values. The integration into Europe has been a kind of, perhaps not a guarantee, but in any case, a support for liberal values, for freedom, for tolerance, for resistance to corruption, and for the rule of law. So that actually has happened. And indeed, when I used to travel in communist Eastern Europe in the 1980s and even the 70s, when people said what they wanted, when I would ask them, what do you really want, when it was possible to speak freely, they would say, we want to become a normal European country again. That's what we want. We don't want anything utopian. We just want to become a normal European country. And of course, that's been achieved in a number of cases. The trouble is that the European normalcy to which they're now becoming part, is a normalcy of chronic European crisis, as happened throughout most of the 20th century. Because although the European Union has many great achievements to its credit, although it preserved peace in the period between the Second World War and the collapse of communism, I think the European project, particularly the project of the single currency, which I know Latvia will join next year, is in some context provoking or accentuating or aggravating a dangerous reaction against liberal values in countries like the ones I've mentioned, and really practically everywhere. In practically every European country now, there are powerful populist movements, including countries which are founder members of the European Union, like the Netherlands. There are powerful movements organized against immigrants, organized against at least some minorities. So I think that's a difficulty. The risk of continued stagnation, the risk of continued contraction, is that this poisonous politics of will carry on. And the risk, I think, is no longer of collapse. I agree with George Soros, who, one of our benefactors here, when he recently said the risk that he saw was not that the euro would collapse. That risk has passed. The risk is that it would carry on for 10 or 20 years, but against a background of a kind of somewhat frozen economy in some countries, at least outside Germany, and a poisonous politics. That's what I see the risk. Then there's a third risk, which I've already referred to at the global level, which is of the growing trend towards illiberal democracies. In the Islamic world or worlds, the replacement of what's followed after the destruction of secular dictatorships in Iraq, for example, in Egypt, has not been a form of liberal democracy, but something more like popular theocracy. It's not classical totalitarianism. If it was classical totalitarianism, like in Stalin's Russia or Hitler's Germany, there couldn't be mass demonstrations. There weren't any mass demonstrations in Nazi Germany, and there are none now in the last remaining totalitarian state, North Korea. The loss of freedom is too complete. The fear and the regimentation is too extreme. But there is something which can be also very harmful to freedom, which is kind of a liberal democracy. So in Egypt, Coptic Christians are under threat. Indeed, Christians are under threat pretty well throughout the Middle East, and probably the last country where they live in freedom might end up as being Israel. And secular dictatorships are replaced either by failed states, collapsed states, or by these types of illiberal democracy. So what I'm trying to do is terribly unoriginal. What I'm trying to remind people of is that liberal thinkers in the tradition of Isaiah Berlin, but going back before Isaiah Berlin to John Stuart Mill in the 19th century, and before Mill, Benjamin Constant, they all supported democracy, including Alexis de Tocqueville. But they all saw dangers in democracy of majority rule. They all feared the emergence of what I've called illiberal democracy. And they all came up with varieties of reform proposals and institutions and systems of checks and balances and of human rights and other things to try and curb that. Mill's case, by the way, Mill was an MP for a while and served MP for rather well, but unfortunately he came up with a system of proportional representation in which the whole of Britain would have been a single constituency. And there are many reasons why that wouldn't work, one being that over the whole of Britain it would actually give a few MPs to the most extreme parties. So his, I think, wouldn't have worked. He also came up with a system of an upper house, he thought, where people with higher education would have more than one vote. If you had a university degree, you would have two votes or three votes. Well, having spent a large part of my life in universities, I'm not sure that would have worked very well, because almost as it's a cliche but perfectly true, is that almost the only last redoubt of communist thinking was Western universities. So I'm not sure that the representative university communism would be a useful part of British or other democracy. But they're all aware of this problem, and they all did their best to come up with various solutions to it, and it's been an almost forgotten problem. The reality of a liberal democracy, the reality of democracy, of there not being just one ideal type of democracy, but a number of types, liberal and illiberal, has been forgotten. So that when dictators are toppled either by their own people, as happened in Egypt, or by Western intervention, as happened in Libya or Iraq, and what emerges is a system in which women are more frightened than they were before, Christians and other minorities are more afraid of being attacked than they were before, if there are any Jews there, they're more afraid of being persecuted or killed than they were before. In other words, a system which is more anarchical, more fragmented, but even less friendly to freedom, or at least as unfriendly as the dictator before, keeps coming as a perpetual surprise. But if one learned from Berlin and from the thinkers that Berlin learned from, Constant and French early 19th century liberal, and Mill, mid and late 19th century English liberal, and others, you wouldn't be surprised by this. You would see it as a permanent danger. So freedom in Russia. Now, you all know more than I do about the recent history of Russia, particularly in the Baltic states, and I'm not an expert on it. So what I'll do is just make a couple of remarks, but beginning by Berlin's view of Russia. And the interesting thing about Berlin's view, and it came out very well in that film, is that Berlin often said and wrote in his letters and elsewhere that everything he cared most deeply about came from the late 19th century Russian intelligentsia. And by which he meant thinkers such as Alexander Herzen, the radical writer and activist and journalist who became an emigre and lived in Switzerland and in London, and wrote a wonderful book of describing his experiences. He knew practically everyone from Mill, Bakunin, almost everybody. Berlin admired those writers and thinkers probably more and identified with them more than he did with anyone else. That's the Russian side of his identity, which is just as important in some respects as the English and the Jewish. And the important feature of Berlin's view of Russia was that he felt so deeply about it because he didn't actually think there was any inexorable law of cultural development which dictated the terrible experience of Russia under communism in the 20th century. If Tsarism had been able to reform itself, if the First World War had not occurred or had occurred differently, if the Bolsheviks had not been able to seize power and the Whites and the Mensheviks had not been so feeble, if Lenin had perhaps died of the flu and they hadn't had a great leader, if Western intervention in the Russian Civil War hadn't been so self-defeating and disorganized, if a whole variety of contingencies hadn't happened, then maybe Russia would have been completely different from the communist state that it actually turned out to be. And the peoples who were then oppressed and, as Berlin put it, enslaved, actually, in the Soviet period, none of that might have happened. So for Berlin, didn't agree with the Marquis de Custine. Many of you may know the Polish writer who traveled in Russia in the early 19th century, I think in 1838, and wrote a book in which he argued that Russia was a culture which was quintessentially tyrannical. That it was always, there was a kind of positive love of tyranny there. Berlin didn't share that view. And one of the reasons he was a cold warrior, as in a much more modest way I was in the 70s and 80s, and I don't regret that for a moment, I was an active and even militant anti-communist in the 70s and 80s, don't regret it at all, it was the right side to be on. And Berlin was too, as you say, when he was answered, do you regret any of that? No, very firm. There's no caution there. He's not saying, well, on the one hand, you know, no, he didn't regret it. He was on the right side. I think it was the right side. I still think that. Was that he thought another Russia had been for a while, perhaps a brief while, some decades of the late 19th century, possible. It was embodied in these great thinkers. And just to say something more about what he liked in these thinkers, I think what he liked in them was a certain type of liberalism which was devoted, which I call anti-sacrificial liberalism. Anti-sacrificial liberalism. That's to say, it was a liberalism devoted not to grand concepts, even of freedom, but to actual human beings. That you certainly don't sacrifice one generation for the next generation, for an imaginary next generation, for a better life, which strangely never comes about. This anti-sacrificial liberalism he found particularly in Alexander Herzen, but also in other Russian writers of the time. He loved that, and that was his own view, and I'm very fond of that too. So he was a Cold War warrior, a Cold Warrior and a Cold War thinker, I think, partly because of his love of that possibility in Russia. A different path was possible, he thought, for Russia, if only for a short time in the late 19th century. But then I go on from him and speak in my own voice now. Just as there's no iron law of culture which forced Russia to be tyrannous or communist, or that made Soviet totalitarianism inevitable, I don't think there's any law of historical development which will bring Russia eventually to liberal democracy. It's an important point if you're as close to Russia as this country is. There is, since the end of the Cold War, there's a kind of theory which has been going around, proposed by Francis Fukuyama, among others, in which essentially as societies get more modern, in the end they, and it was around in the 1960s in the work of American sociologists such as Daniel Benn, that eventually as societies become more modern, more based on science, more based on technology, they have higher economic growth, they eventually converge on some type of liberal democracy. And that was a very strong idea at the end of the Cold War. In 1989, I was in the United States when just before the wall went down, and when it did go down, one of the things I know to be true, it's comical but true, is that a number of big American foundations canceled their grants for foreign policy. Not necessary anymore. We've won. I thought then, and I wrote at the time in October 1989, that this was a terrible delusion, because although I regarded the Soviet collapse as a great advance for human freedom, I also thought there'd be lots of tremendous problems. So, by the way, one of the wisest voices at the time, which no one listened to, was of George Bush Sr. George Bush Sr. said, it's a tremendous achievement, but it's going to be very, very difficult. No one wanted to hear that in the West at the time. It was all over. We'd won, and everything would be okay. And so if one said, well, you know, what will happen next? Aren't there conflicts which have been in Central Asia, in the Balkans, in the Caucasus, and elsewhere, which have been suppressed by Soviet power? Won't they come out again? Won't they reemerge again? No one was interested. If you said, as I did in 1989 in a review of Fukuyama's original essay, which appeared in the summer of the end of history, summer of 1989, I said, this is not the end of history, it's the resumption of history on classical lines. What was abnormal was the period of the Cold War. And classical history means it's about national conflicts, ethnic conflicts, resource conflicts, secret treaties. It's about all the normal stuff. That's what's starting again. People say, oh, that's terrible, that's apocalyptic. Well, not apocalyptic. History as usual can't be apocalyptic. It's the idea that history's ended that's apocalyptic. And yet many serious people believed that, including investors who invested heavily in the immediate post-communist period in the belief that it would turn into a Western market economy, they thought, in a year or two. I thought that was impossible for very obvious reasons. There was no rule of property. It was ecologically devastated. A large part of the Soviet economy was military-industrial rust belt. Enterprise was associated with criminality. It had been throughout the Soviet period. It couldn't move to becoming, it was impossible, literally impossible, that it should become a Western liberal market economy or a Western liberal democracy. It was bound to become some hybrid. Maybe if the mistakes that were made in the West and elsewhere hadn't been made, it would have been a better hybrid than has turned out. But many of the mistakes were, I think, almost inevitable, too. And where this applies now is, I think there's no general theoretical reason, there's no reason to expect whatever happens to the Putin regime, it can't last forever because he can't, and it could suddenly, who knows, turn into something different. I think the likelihood must be now, particularly since developments of the last few weeks even, in which America has become enfeebled not only in its budgetary deadlock and paralysis, but also was outwitted by Russian diplomacy in the Syrian crisis. We have a situation in which, although Russia is weak, although it has demographic problems, although it has an economy which is much too dependent on energy production and natural resources, although it's thoroughly corrupt in many ways, and although I think it will suffer greatly if the Americans press on with developing their own energy, it will suffer the problem of Middle Eastern countries, which is that the price of oil will fall and they'll find their economy, although it has all these problems and will never be efficient, it doesn't need to be efficient to be a threat. And I would, in other words, what I would argue that just as I think there was no necessary inevitability in Russia becoming communist, there's no necessary inevitability in it moving eventually towards liberal democracy either. The likelihood is rather that in the lifetime of everyone in this room, successive versions of a liberal democracy, of authoritarianism, will renew themselves. And as it seems as if this process that's going on in America, whether or not people ask, will there be a default, will there not be a default, I think that's a mistake and question. It's not a unique event that will happen on October the 17th or October the 30th. It's a process which has already begun. Because of the deep ideological divisions in America, they're unable to resolve fundamental questions. And that's pretty deep. So that will go on. And therefore, one can expect that America, though a great power, I lived there for a long time, over many years, very important in the Cold War under Reagan, and a guarantor of freedom in many respects, it's going into a period of retreat, I think. It may not be rapid, won't all be good in its effects. And one of the features of that is that Russia, whatever its internal weaknesses, is likely, has become again, a serious geopolitical player. And the crisis in Europe, I think, makes that a dangerous phenomenon. So we shouldn't fall into the illusion of what I call a kind of inverted Marxism. The inverted Marxism says wherever there are middle classes, wherever there are people getting richer, they'll want Western liberal values. That's Fukuyama's view. That's what they'll want. Do we know that to be true? Well, if you look back at the 20th century, middle classes have often adhered to various forms of ethnic nationalism, anti-liberalism. I think history's not as tidy as that. So where does this leave us? Well, I suppose one insight is the one that Berlin emphasized when he said, choosing is hell. Freedom is a huge benefit for human beings. I don't think human beings can really live very well without freedom, but it's also for many people a burden of choice. All human beings need freedom, but they sometimes find it burdensome, and they also want many other things aside from freedom. Prosperity, security, national identity and religious allegiance are just as powerful in politics as the love of freedom. Feelings of national humiliation, which certainly existed in Russia in the Yeltsin period and afterwards, can be just as important as any economic calculation of self-interest. And in the American case, although there are sophisticated game theorists, most of you know about game theory, which models how people act, they'll come up with explanations of what's happening in now. They'll say, oh, well, look at the boundaries of the constituencies, look at gerrymandering, look at all the different rational choices that they're making. All of that is true. But what's really happening in America now is a clash of radical ideologies with a Tea Party element adhering to a kind of millenarian, that's to say a kind of apocalyptic view that if they can provoke a crisis, everything will work out for them. It's what in Europe we used to call the politics of disaster or the politics of the worst. By the way, the politics of the worst usually leads to a worse worst. It doesn't usually lead to anything better. And I think that will be true if it goes ahead in America, but I still think they'll probably avoid this. But avoid the disaster, but leaving many marks of damage, because in the anxious run-up, asset values of pensions and other assets of the world will decline and people will get very nervous. And this happened in 2011, and it could take quite a long time. And the more often it happens, the more regularly it happens. I mean, if what emerges is a sticking plaster, that's to say a temporary solution, a partial solution, everyone will think, well, it'll reemerge again 6 months from now, or 3 months from now, or 1 year from now. This kind of demonstrates, even in the American case, the most successful 20th century liberal democracy, the preeminent, the one with the greatest achievements, without which we in Britain would have succumbed to Nazism in the Second World War, without which the Cold War wouldn't have ended successfully, without which there would have been no successful intervention in the Balkan War of the 1990s. America is, it seems to be, victim to, is kind of subject to the same ideological conflicts and the same irrationalities of other countries have been. Final point. Like Berlin, I think reason has its limits, and like Berlin, I want people to be as human beings to be as reasonable as possible in politics and elsewhere. But if I had to name the single most dangerous human belief, I would say at the moment the most dangerous human belief is the belief in human rationality. Because it tells us that when you have a looming disaster, people would avoid it. Well, human history wouldn't be what it was if that were true. In fact, there'd almost be no human history at all if that weren't true. So what does this mean for freedom? It means freedom, maintaining freedom, preserving it and extending it is difficult, not just now and here, but everywhere and permanently. Berlin understood this, he taught me this, and that's one good reason why Berlin will always have something very important to teach us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John Gray. We now have a bit of time and the possibility for you to ask questions and perhaps have short reflections on what we've just heard. And there are two microphones, I believe. There's only one floating. Well, maybe you can take this one as well. And John and I will share one. It's called cooperation. And please speak into the microphone. What I request is, if with a question you have also as well comment or reflections, please try to keep it short, and I will cut you off to let other people speak as well and to have John Gravy answer these questions. So one, two, only two, three. Very good. We're starting here. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Valdis Liepiņš. I'm a member of the Parliament, Latvian Parliament. This is difficult because I want to disagree with you on China. The growth in China, you have India right next door, which is a democracy. China started off from a very low level of development, so its growth expectedly would be faster than in a developed economy. And it also relied tremendously on the wealth of the developed economies to pull itself up. So that's one thing. The two more things. One is, you didn't mention the power of big business and lobbying, which is, I think, a danger to freedom and democracy. And I think firmly that some of the problems that the states are going through now is they're really because of the political system there, which is sort of divide and rule, more or less. That's it. Thank you.
Do you want me to reply to that now, or should we hear several? Shall I reply to that now?
Pick a few. Yes.
Okay, maybe we'll take three questions at a time.
Good evening. I'm Petris Termanis. I'm not a deputy of the Latvian Parliament. The Japanese economy has been stagnant for the last 12 years, and it doesn't seem to be losing its freedom or failing in democracy.
Thank you. And a third question right here.
Robert Cottrell. I value your reflections on what seem to be growing tensions between ideas of privacy and freedom. I mean, we're being told more and more now that in order to ensure our freedom from external threats, we need to sacrifice our privacy. Whereas it seems to me that there is at least a large component of privacy in Berlin's notion of negative freedom, which consists in large measure of being left alone. So do you think the assault on privacy is a fundamental change in the way that we live? And do you think it is a fundamental threat to our freedom?
Thank you very much. I'll try and reply. They're all very large and deep questions. Let me reply first on Japan and link that to China. I think the Japanese achievement in enduring 25 years of zero economic growth while preserving social peace and freedom is extraordinary and would be contrasted strongly with what would happen in China. I mean, I've talked to Chinese officials, and what they say is they don't like any comparison with Japan for historical reasons, but what they say is that if they suffered a year or two of growth beneath 4 or 5%, there would be a social explosion. They couldn't last 25 weeks at zero levels of growth. What does that tell me? It tells me that Japanese institutions are legitimate and Chinese ones aren't. Tells me that what's legitimating the economic growth, what's legitimating the Chinese regime, is a mixture of the deep expectation of continuous growth against the background of enormous corruption, which they themselves talk about, and some forms of anti-Japanese and anti-American nationalism. It's ideologically a completely hollow regime. It has very little legitimacy apart from that, whereas Japan has considerable legitimacy. But I don't think that can be replicated elsewhere. In Europe, zero economic growth or negative economic growth absolutely reliably produces poisonous politics. Happened in the 30s, it's happening in a different way now, in Greece, in Italy, not yet in Spain, but it practically everywhere else. So I think this is a great danger. And the idea that any European country which doesn't have strong memories of communism, something worse, the idea that in any West European country could have 25 years of zero economic growth and not display pathological politics, I think is fanciful. America, yes, of course, it's true that the American political system is designed to avoid too much power in any part of it. But of course, it only works when people are ready to compromise. And they're not ready to compromise now. And in America, there's no willingness to embrace fundamental revision of the Constitution, which is a kind of sacred institution, a sacred document, a sacred inheritance. So they're stuck. So the only thing that can happen is that they be sobered by some larger event. I don't see any... what I was struck when I was there by was by the great complacency of opinion. It's all happened before, they said. It'll happen again and again. Well, that's true, but each time it happens in the rest of the world, a certain fear gets slightly larger. And it does inhibit their capacity to act in the world. There's no doubt about that. So I don't see that. I don't see the political system as a strengthening factor. Robert Cottrell's point about privacy. Well, in 2003, I published a 10 years ago. I published a book called "Al Qaeda and What It Means to Be Modern," in which I said that the price of protection against terror, security against terrorism, might turn out to be something like a surveillance society. A society in which everything we do is known to the authorities, and not by endless agents and not by people spying on their neighbors, but through technology, because practically everything we now do is electronically mediated. And this, as it were, has, and I even speculated that, as I put it, the price of individualism may be the loss of privacy. And I think this has sort of almost come about, because although one can argue about how serious a threat it is, one doesn't have to look at 20th century history to see that it could be dangerous. I mean, in Britain and most Western countries, we don't have recent memory of essentially oppressive governments. So the idea is that although the authorities may have all this information, they're going to use it reasonably prudently, and as far as we know, they have. But in future, this may not be the case. However, I can't really see a solution. I suppose I'm often criticized for pessimism, and what this means is that I don't believe all problems are fully soluble. I can't see how this can be resolved, because even if some countries limited themselves in the degree of electronic surveillance they allowed, other countries would not. Russia wouldn't, China wouldn't. And it's hard to prevent this information being used. It's also true, as one of the first speakers said, that, of course, corporate power, a lot of private corporations, often working in conjunction with governments, have gathered an enormous amount of information about us. I mean, now that we all live partly online, our purchases, our computer searches, our emails, our telephone calls, all of that seems to be now readily available. So I do think it represents a fundamentally different way of life, which wasn't possible earlier, even in a society which was full of informers, because the technology didn't exist. Now it does, and seems to be being operated. But I don't see any ready solution. An interesting fact is that most people in Western Europe and America and Britain don't seem terribly bothered. There's no great power. There are some political parties in Western Europe, the so-called pirate parties and other parties, which are working themselves up about this. In America, there's some opposition on the right, oddly enough, as well as the left, but nothing like a mass movement. So what most people seem to feel is that this might be a danger at some point in the future, but the benefits of this new technology are so clear and so apparent that they take it as a kind of price. In other words, they don't really care that much about the loss of privacy. And so I think you're right that Berlin thought of freedom as including privacy. It meant being left alone. But whether being left alone to do what you want is one thing, being left alone and doing what you want, where everything that you do and buy and think and speak is known to the authorities, that's a different thing. And that's almost the situation that we have now in countries such as Britain. And it's a completely new, because technology, it's a completely new situation, which I think we've got to find some intelligent means of dealing with without thinking that there's a full solution. Because in a world where there are liberal states, authoritarian states, one or two remaining totalitarian states, collapsed states, criminal gangs, mafias, large corporations, and no power which can control them all, and they all have access to some of these technologies, at least, there's no way, actually, that it can be prevented, that this kind of surveillance can be wholly prevented.
Thank you. I see a hand here, I see a hand back there, but before I take them, not to discriminate here, we don't have a microphone, is there anyone on the upper tier by the gods who would have a question? Okay, I'll ask later, then we can get a microphone. So, I believe there was one. You stood up. One, two, three. We'll do it in that sequence. Okay, please.
Artis Svets, Latvia University. Thank you for your presentation. I like the idea about the appeal of illiberal democracies. And at one moment in the movie, Berlin was saying that he finds it disturbing when people say that somebody is against progress. And now we know that liberal democracies and illiberal democracies are both quite happy to acknowledge that there is no certain history or certain development of history, no goal that we are going to. And you mentioned that now we know that illiberal democracies are doing quite well economically. And one thing that I think also should be mentioned, that common criticism of Berlin is that his ideas of negative liberties to a certain extent naive, because we all know that, I don't know, we are observed, controlled by corporations and so on. So it seems that illiberal and liberal democracies are becoming more and more similar. So my question is, so why bother to defend a liberal democracy? So what does it have to offer? Thank you.
Yeah. Well, thank you for the presentation. And the question that I'm about to ask will perhaps force you to think a bit outside of the topic that you discussed originally, meaning Berlin. But I wanted to ask, you mentioned about socioeconomic challenges that almost all Western liberal democracies face. And I seem to draw from your presentation that you seem to imply that almost every Western liberal democracy is in economic stagnation. And it is only a matter of time before the danger of tendencies of moving towards liberal democracies will start to come up, if they haven't come up already almost everywhere. And the question I have is that, knowing that while you focused your topic, or you focused on Berlin, what do you think, how big do the solutions have to be in order for a Western liberal democracy to tackle these economic problems? And so basically, what is the alternative to illiberal democracy? Thank you.
I'm Mr. Johnson. I'd like to ask John Gray what he feels might be, for me, and very important matter of what's happening in our overburdening population, world population, and would he consider that to be any threat to any kind of freedom?
Good. Shall I try to answer those three very interesting questions? Why defend liberal democracy? Well, in the world today, the countries in which there is the most negative freedom and in which negative freedom is most secure are the liberal democracies. And although, of course, it's true that liberal democracies also face problems of corporate power and surveillance and other problems, these are not of the scale or of the intensity that have existed in authoritarian and totalitarian regimes in the recent past. It's one thing to say that we are, that what I'm saying now might be recorded without my knowing it, or that as well as knowing it, I mean, in addition to that, it's one thing to say that there may be corporate and other interests involved in our lives and attempted to control them. But there's a great difference between that and a situation in which the borders are closed. You can't leave the country. In which you can't practice a religion without great difficulty. In which you have no choice at all over the type of school, religious or not, that your child goes to. There's a great difference. In the real world, we never find complete or absolute freedom or any other absolute value. In the real world, we face choices between different mixes. And there's a great difference, it seems to me, for example, having traveled extensively in communist Europe as it was in the 70s and 80s, and even the very imperfect societies that came about in the 1990s and 2000s. There was much more freedom of a negative kind. People could and did travel abroad. They could and did practice their religion. They were free of all, many kinds of burdens and unfreedoms that they had before. So liberal democracy is still a great human achievement and should be protected and defended, in my view. But it's not possible everywhere, and we have to recognize that there are illiberal democracies and that even liberal democracy can turn into illiberal democracy, as is happening in some countries in the world and in Europe, and that is a serious risk. I mean, there have been previous periods of history earlier in the 20th century. I mean, I would say, speculatively, some of you may not agree with me here, that there was more negative freedom in the Habsburg Empire than there was in Central Europe for much of the 20th century after the collapse of the Habsburg Empire. What came after it? Fascism, communism, ethnic nationalism. If you lived like Joseph Roth and other writers in, he died mercifully before the Nazi, he died, I think, in 1936, so before the Nazi, not before the Nazis came to power, but before the Second World War, that non-democratic imperial regime, which couldn't be brought back, actually presided over greater freedom in many respects. So historically, it's not always been the case that democracies have promoted the most freedom, but at the moment it is. And by the way, I wouldn't call China a liberal democracy. China is a dictatorship, but it's also a dictatorship which has had tremendous amount of economic progress. And although it's true, as an earlier speaker said, that it's depended on the Western countries for its markets, it's completely different from Russia in that respect. In this following sense, just talk to the hundreds and thousands and millions and tens of millions of Chinese who are traveling the world as tourists now, who come to where I live in Britain and everywhere else. They're coming from a country in which their own incomes have doubled in periods of 7 or 8 years. Now, of course, that can't go on forever because, as pointed out, that's progress and that kind of development slows down when a country emerges from early economic development, but that's gone on since really the end of the 1970s until quite recently. In other words, it's a period of continuous rapid advance. And when they come to the West, most Western countries, they see countries that are relatively stagnant now. Now, I didn't want to say that all Western countries are going to enter stagnation. That's not my view. Or that all Western countries face a kind of zero growth future, but I think it's plausible to argue that most Western countries will not again soon, for whatever variety of reasons, enjoy the economic growth that they enjoyed in the period from the end of the Second World War really up to 2007. Partly because of the debt which still remains to be paid off, and for a whole variety of reasons. And why is this important? It's important because pretty well everywhere in the world, whether it's democratic or not democratic, we have everywhere in the world what I would call forms of popular government. There's nowhere in the world where anyone rules by right anymore. They rule by satisfying the demands of the people. And even in China, the rulers of China are very worried that if the economy slows down, people will be angry and they'll explode. And there are, in fact, hundreds, possibly thousands of demonstrations and popular movements of protest in China every year. Most of them are local, so they don't come to anything much. But they're very aware of that as a risk. And that's important because the chief source of legitimacy in democratic countries, liberal or illiberal, and in dictatorial or non-democratic countries in the last 40 or 50 years has been the expectation of continuing rising living standards. More than freedom, more than rights, more than that. And if that, when that comes, slows down, as it is happening in the West, and you have slow growth, sluggish growth, periods of stagnation and contraction in most countries, there's a very, very new set of difficulties arise, which is how do you have a society which is accepted as reasonably legitimate and reasonably fair by most people when they can't expect the future to be richer than the present, when they can't expect their children to be better off than they are, when in fact they can reasonably expect their children to be worse off. It's a fundamental problem which is happening in America too. Yeah, the biggest source of debt, one of the biggest sources of debt in America, absolutely enormous, I can't remember the figures, is student loans. Absolutely colossal. And many people are in a position, unless they default on it, they'll be paying it off for the rest of their lives at a time when the university degree and education they've had does not secure them a good job. They're working in two or three small jobs, waiters, service jobs of various kinds, earning not enough to pay off even the debt. That is a kind of fundamental problem. You say, what are the solutions? Well, the question was about large solutions. I don't know if there's large solutions. I mean, I tend to think that what we need is flexibility and the ability to come up with a succession of intelligent half solutions. I don't believe there's any big idea floating around which will resolve everything. And in particular, I think the problem in Greece has a peculiar and unusual circumstances. Portugal is different, Spain's different, America's different again, Britain's different in a yet another way. The post-communist countries, including the Baltic states, are different yet again. In each of them has to look to their own historical circumstances and context. I don't think there's any vast solution. But in the developed world, it's certainly true, we're going to have to learn to live with low growth, I think, for a variety of reasons. Now, is overpopulation a problem in the world? I think so. It's not something Berlin ever wrote about, but I've written about it. Even though, here's a sort of piece of, I always try and end on a piece of good news if I can find one. And it now seems that the UN projections of that we'd hit 10 billion by the mid-century might actually underestimate the extent to which population is slowing down. It's slowing down pretty well. Population growth is slowing down pretty well everywhere, much more quickly than many people thought it would. And the reasons aren't always clear. The commonest reason is the emancipation of women. When women are emancipated, they don't choose to have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 children. They normally choose the availability of contraception. But it actually seems to be slowing down even where women aren't emancipated. So something's going on that we don't really understand. And yet, on the other hand, in some parts of the world, for example, Egypt, the population will increase from, I think it's about 80 million now, to about 105 million by 2030. The fertile part of Egypt is about the size of the Netherlands. very serious problem. That's true about the whole Gulf area. China is rapidly approaching a period in which China will get old. China's not far on most projections, 20, 30 years from the situation of Japan. But it's still nowhere near as rich as Japan still is, because Japan started to industrialize in the 1870s and 80s, not the 1970s and 80s. So there are hugely, and in some countries like Latvia or Bulgaria, the population is actually static or shrinking. It's also true, by the way, in Italy and Spain. So I think we're going to have to get used in this respect. In the parts of the world where population growth is ending, that will pose problems and issues. Particularly, by the way, it doesn't make sense to transfer a large debt to the next generation if the next generation is smaller than the one that caused the debt. We've got off the hook in the past because the population has been growing. Let them sort it out. It's kind of rather not very obviously moral way of proceeding, but it won't work either if the next generation is smaller. You have a smaller and smaller generation with bigger and bigger debt. Something's going to happen. So that's a problem. And in other countries, even though the population of the whole world may peak out, some people now think in the mid-century at about not 10 billion, but maybe 8 billion, it's still an enormously high number. And in my own lifetime, I'm 65, the population is well over more than doubled. And in some countries, there are conflicts over water, particularly in Egypt. There are problems in Egypt because the Nile is controlled by other countries, or can be controlled, such as Sudan and others, which can control the water. There are serious problems. I think all these resource conflicts will be very serious. So I think they are serious. But then again, there's no solution which can be applied at the global level because there's no authority to apply it, even if we knew what it was. There's no entity which can go around resolving this. Each country has to make its own pragmatic and intelligent adjustments. But it is, I think, it is and has been a problem. But there may be a kind of tailing off at a very high level of population. John Stuart Mill, by the way, in 1848, wrote that Britain was overpopulated. I think it was about a quarter of the population that it is now, or even less. I can't remember the exact figures. And his reason for that was a kind of interesting. He said, human beings need wilderness, they need space, they need natural beauty. They don't only need the artifices of civilization. I think that's true. So it's a real problem. But in most of these cases, we learn as we go along to adjust to the problem and to resolve it piecemeal, rather than having some great solution. Because the history of the 20th century, and even of part of the 21st, is that big solutions usually come, as Berlin might say, with big casualties. Big solutions come with spilling lots of blood. And at the end of the blood, there's no solution. Plenty of broken heads, eggs, no omelets.
I'm going to take the opportunity to ask a question, which is actually comes out of your interview that you gave to Riga's Laiks, and it's a little bit off this. You, at one point, you seem to urge, maybe that's too strong a word, for individuals to create their own myths. And why do you suggest this? Why do you think we all need our personal myths?
I don't generally argue for individuals to create their own myths. I think myths are not consciously created, and when they have been created, such as Nietzsche created various myths of the Superman, the Ubermensch, and so on, they're ridiculous, normally. The best myths are the oldest myths in general, and the ones that reflect the deepest human experience. So when by a myth, what do we mean by a myth? What we mean by a myth isn't, if you talk to the people like Richard Dawkins in England, or philosophers like Daniel Dennett in America, or a lot of 19th century thinkers, they think myths are, so to speak, primitive scientific theories. That when you develop beyond science develops, that myths cease to be relevant, and we have knowledge instead. I think a good critic of that was Freud, who I think I admire very much. He's tremendously unpopular now, but he wrote to Einstein in a very interesting exchange of letters in the early 1930s, Einstein wrote to Freud saying, well, what we need to prevent war and to prevent horror and barbarism is more education and more reason and more enlightenment. And Freud wrote back and said, yes, yes, they're all very, very good things, but I don't think they'll prevent war or they won't, and so on. And he also said he thought that what he himself called myth, and he said, even my own views, my psychoanalysis, may be a kind of myth, is a part of human life, along with illusions of various kinds, a part of human life. And the idea that we can dispense with myth in illusion is perhaps the greatest illusion and the greatest myth. The idea of a myth-free mode of thinking is itself mythical. But mostly, I think we're better off with older myths, which is why I always tell people, although religions in various forms have done an enormous amount of harm in the world, everything valuable does an enormous amount of harm. Religion does this harm because it's a human institution. It takes part in the imperfection of human beings. Every good thing, love, knowledge, science, art, has done harm. I've often tried to think of a type of technology, for example, that has never done any harm. The closest as I've got to that is anesthetic dentistry. It's very hard. I'm sure Heidegger, if we could bring him back from the grave, would come up with some, he would say that toothache contributes to the existential depth of human existence. But like Berlin, I think I dismiss that as nonsense. The English writer Thomas de Quincey wrote in the early 19th century, he said, a third of all human suffering is toothache. Which it probably was then. So I think anesthetic dentistry is about as close as I can get to a completely unaltered, a pure good. It's very hard to imagine that. I think I'll give up anesthetic dentistry and live a more exciting and deeply meaningful life. I think that's a kind of absurdity. So all human institutions, religion included, have these negative features or deep harms. But religious myths in general, the myth of Genesis, which tells us in the Old Testament that knowledge can be used for bad purposes as well as good purposes, is a profound observation, a profound truth. The growth of knowledge doesn't make human beings more reasonable. It simply makes them able to do more things, give them more power. Even the knowledge of psychology and sociology and human nature can be used for terrible results, as the Nazis used their knowledge of mass psychology. One of Freud's relatives wrote a book on propaganda, one of the greatest books on, called Edward Bernays, emigrated to America, and he was horrified to hear that some of the CIA Nazis had read it and were applying it. As he should have been horrified, he was quite right to be horrified, but all human knowledge, without exception, can be used for good and bad purposes. So I think the old religious myths. Now, if you, on the other hand, and this is maybe what you were referring to, is there are many people without religions. I don't belong to one myself. And we're also living in a time when a fragmentation and when things are changing very quickly. And it may be that people find themselves not inventing. One can't concoct a new myth the way we mix a new cocktail. They may find themselves living by a personal myth. One of the writers I knew who died recently, who grew up in Shanghai during the Second World War, developed a kind of personal mythology whereby he could heal the wounds. I think he partly healed the wounds, the writer J.G. Ballard, which he experienced as a young boy, of witnessing, of living in a concentration camp, and witnessing terrible things. He developed a kind of personal mythology, which was, as he told me, he said, I spent 20 years forgetting it, another 20 years remembering it. And his myths were purely personal. So it's possible that, but they weren't consciously created. He said he wrote his stories for 20 years without realizing fully that they were forms of his childhood trauma, actually, were reemerging. And later on, he tried to unravel that. The main thing is to accept that it's unreasonable to think that human beings can ever be fully rational. And to quote something from Berlin, which we can perhaps end on, I loved the phrase, which I didn't remember when I first saw that filmed interview in 1997, 16 years ago. I didn't remember that he used the phrase, irrationalism called rationalism. irrationalism under the mask or disguise of rationalism. And there's a certain type of militant rationalism which promotes unreasonableness because it demands of human beings more rationality than they can give. And it also, by the way, and this is no small matter, assumes a greater degree of rationality in the rationalist than they are themselves really capable of. A rationalist, from my point of view, is someone who's never questioned his or her myths. Thank you.
I'd like to thank John Gray for allowing us to ruminate, question our own assumptions, bring thoughts farther than maybe we've thought for quite a while, and for actually a very enjoyable evening. Thank you very much. As traditionally done, we invite you all now for a little reception, a little wine, a few nibblies, Irina, I hope. She's saying yes to nibblies. This is very good. Just outside here. And we hope to see you back again next year. Let's remember that next year, Riga is European cultural capital. And we have to... You know, the Isaiah Berlin Association is even now thinking of how can we make it even more special next year, the Isaiah Berlin Day. So come back, see you soon. Enjoy the conversation with wine. Thank you.